In a narrow studio in London, our next one to watch is preparing to breathe life into her imaginary world.
The life-size technique that I've been doing, it's as though you're creating a real world. And there's something about wanting the sort of illustration world to come out of the canvas and be real that I really like. In stepping into your own painting, it's really about playing God in a funny way. I can create any character I want, any story I want, and that's quite a sort of powerful thing, really.
This is what happens when she animates.
Is that you, Richard?
Her wall paintings come to life and reach into space with their papier-mâché arms.
You are a good boy.
Hoovers suck up rooms. And mugs overflow with water. Her graduation film, The Bigger Picture, won a BAFTA and was nominated for an Academy Award. Her originality has made her Sylvain Chomet's one to watch.
So I selected Daisy Jacob as the one to watch in animation because I saw a film which really, really, really moved me.
I'd do anything for you.
I know.
It's full of humanity and it's beautiful. It's sad and moving and very warm at the same time. Some people would basically try to take a camera and actors and try to make that happen, you know, in our film. And they wouldn't manage to get the result she gets, you know, with just drawings.
And I'll be old.
There's a lot of boring things like that, you know, when you go to festivals. At some time, someone managed to make it absolutely unique. And I think she did that.
You should be really looking to be original. You should be doing work that is you, not anyone else. So I think imitation is the biggest sin in art.
Today, Daisy is amongst the pots of glue and paint, surrounded by papier-mâché arms and legs, and cupboards filled with objects from car boot sales that will inhabit her new world. Together with her co-animator, Chris, she's making props for her new movie, which will tell the story of the 80s divorce boom.
These are some of the like mock-up, smaller sets, sort of miniatures to just give us an idea of what we're doing. Obviously, you know, they're going to be real props in the foreground. So for example, this is a leaf I'm making from, that'll be just one of these leaves here, maybe this one, like just one leaf is this. So it gives you an ideal of the scale. So you've got this guy here. He's about the size of a sort of 6'4" man. So these arms come out of the wall so that they can interact with things like the cups and so on. I would say the greatest challenge for what we're doing is simply that it hasn't been done before and that we're constantly adding to that language that no one else has yet added to. So we're very much innovating and that comes with lots of things going wrong.
If she needs nights, she has to go into a home.
Well, maybe the time has come.
She's not going in a home!
The bigger picture told the story of two sons dealing with their mother's impending death.
Well, I think animation really has that ability to sort of tell these dark stories. If things are too real, they can be too hard to watch, or they're just too much to take in. Putting it into animation, it allows sort of the viewer to really get into those dark, quite depressing, I suppose, topics, but with some form of detachment. Really challenging one was definitely when we did the sort of pour. We had to literally move 2 kilometres worth of cling film around the room. The Hoover scene I think took about 2 weeks to animate, and we had to break everything down as it was sucked up into the Hoover. But it was actually a very fun one. In contrast to something like the clean-up scene of the mum, where I was on my own, I did it in a corner of the room. I wanted it to be very quiet, because it's a very emotional scene, so I wanted to be alone. I didn't want anyone else in there. I closed all the doors, turned the lights off, just had the one light there.
I'm so sorry, love.
The first moment I ever made anything that moved, I thought it was pretty amazing, but for me, it was when I first made something that spoke. So I had lip-synced a character. I think it said something like, I'm not interested in your opinion, or something, this very sort of strange little man I made.
I'm not arrogant. It's just I'm not interested in anyone else's opinion.
I remember thinking, this is beyond amazing. I've actually made something speak to me, back at me. It's a bit like, I suppose, like giving birth or something.
Back in the studio, the magic begins.
What I love about animation, I think, is that it's essentially I'm acting a character. We're injecting ourselves and our ideas into these objects. I really feel as though I am the character, to the point where when I'm not painting them, I still think I'm them. Because after you've learned everything, how to animate, how to do everything, I think something else takes over and it's more about flow. And I think the flow is really becoming the character.
Daisy has that special power that takes over. A great animator is not just a master of movement or a top technician, but an actor with an ability to tap into what makes us human, to create characters that move us, that make us laugh, and make us reflect on our very existence. That is the true power of animation and the power of our ones to watch.